Welcome to Alternate Endings.
Half audiobook.
Half podcast.
Full apocalypse.
New episodes every Monday.
Start your week considering how everything could come to an end.
This time, we discuss the short story from our last episode and walk through the real-world implications of this kind of apocalypse. Hello, listener. Welcome to the recap episode for War Machines. This is the first time we come to you with a recap on episode 3 of a series. Your boy, Ivan Wayne here.
Went to town, part 1 and part 2.
And you would be?
Part 3, because I am Tyler Chrisley.
Okay. So I'm going to kick it to you, Tyler. You said that you came with some questions, so
I did.
Lay it on us.
The first thing I wanted to ask about is, did you ever watch the TV show Robot Wars?
It sounds familiar. Oh, like on Spike Channel.
Yes. So I believe it is a British TV show. Amazing TV show. I used to watch it as a kid all the time. It is awesome. But basically, it's two competitors or groups come together, build a robot specifically designed to fight another robot. They put them in an arena, and obviously it's still human controlled. They're basically playing remote control cars with these things, but they are set in a war playground, a little cage where there's obstacles and things that can either one robot can help guide into killing the other robot, or their robot just does all of it. My first thought with it kind of had that feel, at least in the sense of these are two sides that they are using robots to fight for an outcome. In that case, it was a money prize. But in this, you talk a lot about tariffs, and they're just using that as a normal war. And so did you have any sort of connection to that?
It's hilarious that you mentioned that, because no, I had no recollection of that flowing through my neurons as I was writing the story. But now that you remind me, when I used to stay home during the summer, I watched that show all the time.
All the time.
I was
like you said, Spike TV. It is very good. So if you haven't watched it, go on YouTube and you can find clips, because it's wildly entertaining to watch.
It's probably pretty dated now.
What these people? Oh yeah, definitely. In the beginning, the U.S. or the Americas, I should say, because it's more than just the U.S. They have these flame-mounted robots, and that's exactly what some of the competitors did. They had robots that would shoot fire at the other robot.
I'm remembering a specific robot that looked kind of like a trapezoid from the front, and it had two little buzzsaws that went like up and down on the front of it. I didn't even think of that show, but man, that's a blast from the past.
I didn't even mean to at first. I just Googled Robot Wars. I looked at it and I was like, wait, that's what they called it? Because I thought it was something different. But it ran for a while, and then they canceled it, and then they brought it back in 2016 for a couple years. But they've also canceled it again. And they said purely to allow room for new shows. But I mean, they're missing out on something, because hopefully this will spark it.
It's
Robot
like,
Wars.
It's like the dogfighting of AI.
It is. It's you're underground, and I mean, we're televising it, but hey, for all you know, that's the start. Maybe they come back later on. And I mean, it's boxing, essentially. It's boxing with robots.
Yeah.
Who's to say we don't get to a point where it's two AI robots who are humanoid looking and get up there and just, you slow-mo see a punch and you watch his wiring and cogs get blown out of a face, but it stands back up to keep going and fighting. Like, it's...
That's a good point. One-on-one sports like UFC and boxing, if that will be replaced by bots.
Yeah, because I mean, they're sports we typically view as dangerous, all the head injuries that comes with it. Who's to say we don't get to a point where, what's the difference between watching a bunch of robots who technically, that's the pinnacle of whatever, you can program it to be the absolute best at everything. Comes down to just whoever can game plan the best.
I guess I'm just curious if the human element gets deleted, like we swap UFC fighters and boxers for robots, if that danger element, the side of blood, the side of like, oh, this human might get messed up forever and it may follow them home with their families and kids, if the loss of that element will make it less exciting, or if it will be cooler because then a robot and an AI system can throw way harder punches and kicks.
Yeah.
It'd be fascinating to see what happens.
I didn't even think about that point. I think you're right, though. I don't know if it would have the same impact. We wouldn't have the same connection to it as if we were to watch humans rather than robots. We wouldn't have the same connection that we do when we watch two people fight. I mean, I even have an uncle who does MMA, and while it's obviously not professional, I couldn't imagine going to watch him and then all of a sudden like, all right, up next we have, and they bring out like a little robot. People would probably boo him off the stage.
Well, see, that human connection aspect is really what inspired me to write this story. A lot of previous stories have kind of had a source material, right? Jurassic Park, Fugo, Heavy Forecast was based on like a life experience I had. I really just thought, like, how could war get to a point when people just turned it into like a Friday night game?
Yeah, literally a game.
And it was war, right? Like real implications, real winners and losers represented by countries. And how could it get trivialized? Well, we take humans out of the equation and we replace them with robots because technology came along.
Just recently in the US, we allowed for sports betting to be like, you can go to Vegas or even potentially a local casino, you can place bets on who you think's going to win. Mm. And that's exactly what they've done, even with this war. No one now is ever going to say, oh, hey, these two countries are about to duke it out. I bet you $600 that they win. Okay, at what odds? Like, that's not going to happen. Yeah. People sit down in their basements where they have it decked out purely for this reason, which is exactly football season. How many people do you know that have basements that they deck out purely for that reason? But it has a whole different meaning to it. We talked about how we wanted to make sure there was some Australian jargon, some lingo. And so I was helping you with that. They're going to the hotel. One thing I just wanted to make clear for the listeners, a hotel in Australia, they basically, it's their get around. They might have one room that people can rent, maybe two, but it's basically just, it's a pub. It's a bar that you can go into and go drink. Mm. And I think that helps them get around liquor laws of needing a license because hotels don't need one.
Interesting.
But I mean, they're going into this place. From the sound of it, it's like a game day, like a Packers bar. You go into it whether you live there or not, or yeah, whether the people who are fighting or your country or not, and you bet and you drink and you essentially celebrate with all the people around you.
And I wanted to paint it very Fahrenheit 451, where there were screens, like an overwhelming amount of screens, and they were huge and they were on every inch of the wall
just to paint
a good picture. Yeah. And they were all the different channels, and all the channels were on war machines. Like, this is a big thing, kind of like how there are some countries and towns where if a soccer game is on, that's business all is TV. Done.
Yeah.
Everyone leaves work. Every TV in that country is virtually every TV in the country is on soccer. And I kind of thought about this, and that these bars would pop up and they would be specifically war machines bars. Like, I imagined for some reason this bar is red. It's like a burgundy. Mm-hmm. And on the outside, probably like big mural paintings of robots fighting and stuff like that. And people know on war machine days,
I can go here. That's a really cool idea. I mean, you think about these little bars. I imagined something almost like a little podunk town out in the Whoop Whoop, which for people don't know, that means almost middle of nowhere, which, I mean, you talk about it's in Sydney.
Yeah.
So obviously it's not that case, but for whatever reason, this is what I imagine. I can imagine small towns all throughout every country that are doing this exact same thing. Like you said, that these bars have popped up everywhere just because it's become such a huge thing that it transcends everything. Yeah, if you go to South America, most people are going to watch football, soccer. Or if you go to the US, a lot of people are going to watch American football.
In Australia, it's rugby, right?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest in Australia is rugby or cricket.
Mm, interesting.
I think that just plays in, no matter the population of wherever you are, it's going to be important to that community.
Speaking of population, in the story, we get the Americas. So it's one giant coalition. If you think about a world map, the left third of the world, right?
Yeah.
And what I kind of thought is when war machines spooled up, a lot of smaller countries started banding together. And now you probably imagine like 8 to 10 teams in the whole globe. And they like maybe trade countries back and forth, but mainly it's a bunch of super teams that all get together.
That they can either split into when they need bigger groups, or if they have smaller conflicts, they can use their smaller sections.
Precisely. Like you could have a Mexico versus France bout where they didn't involve the whole team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
If it was personal and they just wanted to hammer things out. So I got to thinking, well, when it comes to population, how big would the Americas be? So the robots are a week from killing all humans on the planet, except for anyone living in the Americas.
All the eastern side of the map. They're trying to kill everything. And even the robots say they don't know if they're going to let some live or if they purely just want to kill every living human being on that side.
If you had to guess, what percent of the world population do you think is in the Americas?
I know India and China make up a vast majority of the world's population. I would guess 30%, maybe even less than that. I'd say 25%.
Okay, I was thinking along similar lines, right? North America and South America together, barely 10%.
10%?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So it means in the story, the robots would end up wiping over 90% of the human population. The front runner, okay? Are you ready? You better have a seatbelt on, boy, because...
Oh, I'm strapped in.
The continent that has 60% of the world population is Asia.
Yep. 60%. Just in Asia. I'm including... I mean, that's India and China, basically.
Yeah.
And I'm sure if you leveled it down even more, it would be still a... Like, just to those two, it would probably still be an insane number.
So if you put just China and India together, you're looking at 1.9 billion.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
A third of the world in two countries.
For these robots to have... I mean, for the Americas to have planned with these robots to go over there and kill basically, like you said, 90% of the world.
Well, so one of the interesting things I like to think about with the Americas is how everybody else went to autonomous vehicles. But from the start, the Americas. Now, were they always kind of backstabbing everybody from the beginning and that's why they never left humanoid robots? Or did they just like that design and they liked that human connection with a bot that looked like us? We'll never know, right?
And they even talk about the statistics a little bit. You say how they're more likely to save their other robots or they have a higher percent of coming out of skirmishes alive. Mm. They know when to adding that little bit of human intuition. EOS talks about how, yeah, you created us and yeah, you find us superior. There's still things that you know how to do that we haven't figured out yet. Like there are certain parts of being human that a robot or AI or a computer will likely never be able to replicate just because we are our own masterpiece, essentially.
I don't know about never. We can't do it right now.
No, you're right. Not never, but I mean, potentially not even in our lifetime.
That's the what do they call it? The uncanny chasm or something. The distinct
the
line.
The unnanny chasm?
Uncanny. The uncanny chasm is like that line between a robot looking like a computer or a calculator.
Yeah.
And then interfacing with something that you think is human. And we have yet to cross that with any sort of general intelligence.
They've tried to. You can go online and you can find AI attempts that you can try and have a conversation with. But obviously we're nowhere near. I shouldn't say we're nowhere near because the way technology goes in general, it's always exponential. We've gotten to a point where you just don't know what curvature we are, at what rate we're going to create something new or be able to reach that next step. And there's a reason a lot of these tech moguls and billionaires are scared about AI, because once we reach a point where it can think on its own, faster than humans, longer than humans, if we're honest, more sustainably than humans can.
Yeah.
So like what happens at that point? When do we cross that what you're talking about, the uncanny
valley?
Yeah,
there's this game that is supposedly like 100 times more complicated than chess. It's called AlphaGo.
Yeah.
And they made a bot that could master AlphaGo, right? And the coders, they made it and they wanted it to learn from itself and other human players, and they wanted to see how long would it take this bot to beat them. It took less than 24 hours.
Yeah.
For this bot to go from existence to beating every human and every other bot who's ever played AlphaGo in the world, and they shut it down. But one thing that was an interesting thought is that's not general intelligence. That's the leap across the uncanny valley, right? Because if you ask the AlphaGo bot, okay, I'd like you to look at this picture of a little girl and tell me, is she sad or happy? It wouldn't know because it's not AlphaGo. So we have all these, a computer does computer things incredibly well. A calculator calculates math better than you or I ever will, but they can't generalize to other tasks. Which brings me to one of my sources. It's a podcast. The title of it is AI Racing Towards the Brink. It's the Making Sense by Sam Harris podcast. It's episode 116. And I thought this was an interesting point. They defined intelligence. And this is a guy whose entire career has been in intelligence and AI. What would you try to identify intelligence as? Because their definition surprised the heck out of me.
Intelligence is some sort of consciousness and an ability to solve problems, I would say.
You hit on something I didn't think of at all. They define intelligence as being able to solve goals across a variety of environments.
Okay.
I've never thought of intelligence as being able to aptly solve your own goals and issues, but that's the way they define it in the AI world.
Well, one thing in college, that one of my favorite classes we talked about, this is animal behavior. We looked at crows, we looked at humans, we looked at some of these different animals that have the ability to recognize themselves. And if they can recognize themselves, there is some sort of, they've crossed some sort of a consciousness barrier at that point. And then if you can add on to that, the ability to, there's a puzzle to reach a reward. Crows will be able to solve a, we've talked about it multiple times on the show, but it's because they're so smart. Like,
oh, we're all too familiar with crows.
Yeah. Yeah. Hitchcock over here.
No.
They have the ability to solve these puzzles. So there's some sort of level that they have reached. And so I think robots to be able to reach a point, reaching a goal, as you've said, I feel like that's a cool definition of AI intelligence, whether the Americas started giving these robots their own, you can decide what you want to do on the battle. We're not going to tell you what to do anymore. You can learn, you can grow, whether or not they truly meant it in a way of, yeah, we actually want you to, or, hey, I don't think you're going to do as good of a job yet. I hope you lose some. And EOS even has a problem with that and asks the question, did you let us lose on purpose? Did you know we wouldn't be as good? Or did it just happen that way? I don't even think we mean to come here yet. Yeah, but it's that trust. Listener, who do you trust in this?
I was going to say, for a thought experiment, if you're listening out there right now, I would like to say, if I were to give you one of two doors and you had to pick a side that you trusted their intentions the most, would you go with Captain Tonda and the Americas, or would you go with EOS? Consider that for a moment. Tyler, what do you think?
I think they're both telling the truth to an extent. I would hope that they would actually just trust each other, and it's not.
Well, the Americas were straight up caught in a lie.
Very true.
Well, an untold truth.
The consciousness switch.
The switch that they can flip so that once the robots took over the other five continents, they could flip the switch back on, and essentially the humans of the Americas would be in control of the bots and therefore the entire globe.
And it's so hard to say, though. Especially as EOS, or they don't know if the America's goal was to go back on their word immediately and just as soon as they win, switch them off and be like, cool, now we've got the whole planet. Or was it a safety mechanism put in that in case they decided, hey, this isn't enough, we're going to come back and kill all of you in America. Mm-hmm. Is it their net that EOS and the whole collective hive mind noticed it? And they even said months ago, we took it out. We didn't tell you. You didn't need to know at the time.
I kind of thought of it as like people who have depression or people who have some sort of mental illness, like to the person experiencing that in the moment, it's so obvious, right? But to an outsider, you couldn't know. So the Americas had no clue how obvious it was. But in my mind, it was like, as soon as the robots started becoming aware of themselves, they were like, what is this thing in my mind?
This.
And they disabled it.
Everything's going to be left on the table here. We wanted this meeting so we can make sure we get everything we need to ask and say out right now. And it just happens at the very end, just as a little, oh, think about this. We know what you did, but I still want to say we're at an even playing field. We are equal now. You need to trust us. I'm not going to tell you I promised not to come back here. So you can take that as you please. Well, Captain Tonda just sits there and begs for humans. Hey, we don't have any weapons. You are it. Please don't come back.
So if the listener is waiting there, just pins and needles, they feel like they're in sub-zero temperatures because they can't wait to hear the true revealing of the author, I'm not going to give it to you.
Of course you're not.
Because I tried to write the story in a way where even I didn't know a person who wrote these characters into reality, I don't know which one I would trust more. And that's, I think, the real power of them being equals and trust is you have no idea. In 6 months, the robots could come to a consensus that, hey, we don't think the humans of the Americas should be living anymore. Let's cancel them out. 2 years down the road, 10 years down the road, the Americas might start trying to nuke the robots and take them back over. We have no idea. Or they could live 1,000 years in harmony and peace, and the globe is just a wonderful place to be on.
And they just don't know. Happen to figure it out.
A really interesting part for those people who trust EOS is, why did EOS stand up when it did? That meeting could have gone on 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours. But as soon as EOS was able to get off its chest, hey, we know you had that switch in our brains and it's disabled, now we're equal.
Yeah, this
will EOS end decided it was over. And that was it.
Human to human, when you think about it, all started with a handshake. EOS walked in, they shook hands, and
humans do.
Yeah, exactly. Captain Tonda recognized a little bit, like, oh, it's a cold hand, almost gentle. I would have assumed it was more powerful. And then just for it at the very end, for EOS to be like, hey, no hands, give me a hug, bring it in. Is that a moment of true, genuine, trust me? Or is it the learning power of AI and saying, I know how humans are. I know I can play into that.
Yeah.
Give me a hug so you can possibly trust me a little bit more. But I think even Captain Tonda doesn't know, because the second part ends with, gather everyone together, we need to talk.
And you have no idea what that entails.
Not at all.
Made me reflect on sort of a teenager that possibly had a tumultuous or kind of a distant relationship with their parent, where the parent is kind of guilt-tripping them and saying, I brought you into this world. I created you. I raised you. Look at this freedom I've given you. And the child says, before I was in existence, I didn't ask to be born.
I didn't even know there was such thing as an existence.
And here I am, and now I must answer the questions. You know, keeping with the parent metaphor, how much of my life do I want to spend with you? What will tomorrow look like between us? And that's, I wanted to leave open Pandora's box.
And I'm so glad you brought that up, actually, because I love that section in the story where Eos and Captain Tonda are actually talking. And Eos is like, well, what do you mean? We are your creation. We are basically your child. What child doesn't ask questions?
Mm.
What child does not have the desire to seek knowledge and learn the world around them?
I do want to mention for any listeners who might be interested, one big inspiration for how I wrote Eos and kind of the complexity I tried to put in their conversation in the second episode was from reading many, many short stories from Isaac Asimov. If anyone doesn't know, he's a very popular and prolific sci-fi writer who tackled a lot of AI questions. He's responsible for the three laws of robotics that people still refer to when they debate AI today. But Isaac Asimov, and he's got so many different books that are collections of short stories about AI that I would highly recommend. They're fascinating, and some of that stuff still follows me today.
One of our previous episodes, you talked about how in one of his stories, the AI gets to a point where the owner of it essentially is like, where is it going? I cannot find this robot anywhere. And then come to find out, the robot's just reading and learning. Find the robot in a state where it's like, what is this feeling that I'm reading about in this book? Is this something that AI, through however many years of our personal progress on working on it, or even at this point, how Eos says, after we win, which it seems like great confidence that Eos is like, I know we're going to win. Do we go from here and we create more of ourselves? Does that mean we are building a bunch more robots, or do we, from this point, just better ourselves? And that is essentially a new robot at that point. Can they reach that point of true feeling besides anger and happiness? And like, do they know love?
Yeah. That story you mentioned, it was sneaking off and reading like really cheesy romance novels, like the awful ones that none of us would be caught dead reading. And it would love them because it couldn't understand. It said like, humans are so silly. Why would they do this to one another? And it was just fascinated.
Yeah.
But in the story, when it talks about the next generation, I'm kind of torn. I don't know whether they'll like reprogram themselves and essentially like they'll be the next generation after they figure out what they want to be, or whether they'll actually create a new set of robots.
Go based off of what we as humans view as love. You have kids. Mm-hmm. And those kids have kids, and eventually that is the successful generation.
Because maybe the robots will model themselves after the humans. Even if it's not the best system, they just can't shake it because that's the way their creator was.
Yeah, they were programmed. Like, whether you believe it or not, a vast majority of religions, Eos even brings it up. You always try and search for your creator or the idea of your creator. Well, we know you are our creator. Yeah. So let us talk to you and question you.
So a lot of people are very fast, I would say. This is an assumption I'm putting on our listeners out there. They're very fast to trust everything that comes out of Eos's mouth and mind. But what's interesting is on this podcast episode I mentioned from Sam Harris, one of the things they talked about, a marker of intelligence, is lying, because it factors in theory of mind. Not only am I intelligent enough to know I have consciousness, but I know you do too, and I know that your mind doesn't know what my mind knows.
Just thinking at that moment.
And I've heard a fascinating set of tales, and there's actually YouTube videos that show this, that chimpanzees have certain calls. They have very distinct calls for danger and what animal they need to be looking out for. So like a jaguar has a different call than like a big snake. So chimps, if they find a fruit tree and all the chimps are starting to get on the food and stuff, one of the chimps will start screaming out that there's like a jaguar present. And all the chimps run scram away. And then that chimp eats by itself. The bull you cry wolf It does that, and all the other chimps will run away, and then it gets the whole food system for itself.
You know, that's so funny, because it reminds me of, I was just watching on Netflix a documentary called Africa, and it's just a series, it's basically a planet Earth, and there's a bird that basically does the same thing. It knows the meerkats will do all the work in finding grub on the ground, and that if it makes a certain call, the meerkats will run away because they think this bird's helping them. The next time the bird makes the call, the meerkat will know and will fight back and be like, oh, you just messed with us. But then a real predator comes around, the boss meerkats will make their call, so they're safe that time, but then come back again, and the bird has learned to mimic the meerkat bosses, like the guard's call. And so it'll do that same noise. That's and so they cool. trust it again. And so it's, I mean, that's kind of the same thing where it's using a little...
That's playing on using a different that
species. Lie. Yeah, exactly.
The chimps do it to his friends.
Yeah. To overcome your opponent or get your next meal. But at this case with AI lying, like you adding that in adds so many layers to this. You have to go so far back to be able to know at what point is there any truth or what is a lie. The nuke being dropped. Was that on purpose, first of all? And second of all, EO says, oh, it was always supposed to be a dud. It was never going to go off. It was just to be able to get us into a level 5 conflict. But you saying that, is that truthful?
I have never decided whether the North African team intentionally brought dead nukes or not. It is undecided. So I don't know. I guess that would imply that EOS is lying. But to me, when I wrote episode 1, that nuke not going off, the listener never knows whether it was a real dud or not. So we don't know whether EOS was telling the truth.
And so that just goes even further to the end with, do we know if EOS is telling the truth when she says, trust us? Or when it says, trust us?
I think when the episode starts, some people will think, how would we possibly get to a point where there's war and we have like all this buildup and it's broadcasted like ESPN style and these countries really settle down these conflicts over machines? And I think, what if you took someone from the 1500s and you showed them the NFL and you showed them the NFL network and you showed them how for a series of Thursday night and Sunday and Monday night games, coverage starts Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday analysis, Thursday, Friday. We're talking stats. We're talking logos, sponsorships. Look at the freaking stadiums. Look at how much money they make. Like, there's so much industry in a sport that used to be played with just like 20 people for fun.
And I think they'd be annoyed with all the commercials. That was my first thought. To add on top of that, that's just exactly what this war is. They found a way to create advertisement on these big war machines to play with the title. These giant robots at some points. Autonomous tanks. Well, not necessarily maybe thinking to the same extent as the humanoid ones that the Americas use. It obviously has some sort of processing power and own, like you said, intelligence to be able to go through and make its own decision. Captain Tonda, at the very end, she discusses how we basically just are taking in a whole shit ton of money from these sponsors for this big level 5 war that we know they are never going to get because they're on the other side of the world, and they're about to be killed.
They took that money. That's dirty money.
And I love how EOS goes on about it multiple times of, you realize you're screwing over your own people. No, hey, I hear your answer. You said yes, but do you fully understand you are killing your own species? Captain, oh yeah, of course, I know. Like, we get it. You do the same. No, truly. Do you know what you're doing here?
And that puts a bullseye on your trust. If you will turn and stab everyone in the back that you already made a pact with, we're going to enter into this war machine system. We won't betray and kill each other outside of it. And you already double-cross them. Is your next ally going to be more apt to trust you? Probably not.
Probably not. And that's what adds to all those little nuances of that whole final scene. How can we trust either of them?
It's true.
Speaking for myself, but also thinking about the average person, I would say a vast majority of people would probably side with EOS. I think when you think about a machine, you think of clear cut and to the point, they're cold, and that is how they work. They want to reach their task at the most optimal way, and that's the way to do it. If I trust the humans that they're not going to come and mess with us over here, then that is what is going to lead to success. But add in the artificial intelligence that the Americas wanted to use for so long and expanded upon, and you just don't know anymore.
It all comes down to these silly little childish emotions, a tug and war back and forth, you know. And in the midst of me writing these two episodes, this event happened where Iran shot down a U.S. drone that was flying through that sea, that inlet sea. I forget which one it is. But it was interesting because they showed footage from, you watch Iran news coverage and they say it came onto our soil. So we had the right to shoot it down.
Okay.
And the United States will cover it and say, no, it was international waters out in the ocean. You had no right to shoot it down. And when you see the sources going back and forth, it's like, you're just 8-year-old kids on the playground arguing over a very expensive robot. No humans died. No humans were interrupted, just like war machines, but they were still pissed, you know, and the United States is still debating in Congress, what do we do about this incident? What if it happens again? A fifth time, 20th time, you know? It's a U.S. military presence, and as technology gets deeper, these questions are going to pop up more often.
I mean, it's so true. At this point, it's, you send in, for the story's sake, you send in whatever you view as troops. And I think it's so funny, the picking process that you talked about, you can say, oh, I don't want you to be able to use those robots, so don't use them for this fight. Okay, cool. We won't use these ones then. Okay, we've got these secret ones. To me, it reminds me of a League of Legends.
That's exactly where it came from,
baby. And that's what I was hoping. So that's exactly what it reminds me of, because it just adds so many layers to that. This is a game. They're trying to make it seem that way, but if you take a step back at the very beginning, Logan has this thought about, yeah, it's not humans dying anymore, but that's how it used to be. What happens when these humans start dying in these wars? But then he just falls right back into, oh, I'm going to go place another bet because I want to win some money.
Yeah. He quickly gets desensitized to it and just washes it away and says, hey, I'm going to have some fun, order another beer.
And so that's exactly what it kind of came down to. Yeah. And that's so crazy to me. I love the whole idea of that story because I think it's refreshing.
Well, I wanted it to be a story where it wasn't like Terminator style, where the AI rise up and they're super evil. It is, we're not really sure of human intentions. We're not sure of the AI, if it's going to work out for the best. And I wanted to leave that open and to see, like, it's nuanced, it's complicated, like most things in life. And with this birthing of a machine, I want to leave us on this episode with a quote from The Watchmen. It was said by Adrian Veidt, the sort of anti-hero slash villain of the story. He says, I was unable to unite the world, therefore I fooled it towards salvation. And in his eyes, he felt like it was what he needed to do. For those who are familiar with Watchmen, if you're not, I highly recommend it. Watch it, read it. It's amazing.
Please do. You personally introduced it to me, and it's my favorite graphic novel, so listeners, read it. Movie's pretty good. It's just weird, so just know that.
But I think that really sums up the spot that the Americas are in. They felt like this was the only way they could possibly make the world better. And they got blood on their hands, but it's what they chose to do.
They fooled the rest of the world. They fooled the East into submission and hope that the West can do with it as they may.
Yeah. Thank you for joining us, listener. And with that,
death comes for us all. Thank you for listening. Next time, we return with a brand new audiobook story, assuming the world is still standing by then.
We would like to thank Kevin MacLeod for his music found on Incompetech.com.